Hello, NAB 2016. My name is Ryan Corcoran, and behind the monitors is my colleague, Garner Millward, in the monitor. Today, we're going to be talking about expression in sports, what you can do with it, the feature set, talking about things like fast recall speed, package reskinning, data connectivity, custom dashboard panels, transition logic, all the things you need to know how expression fits into your sports workflow. So let's kick things off with talking about recall speed. So expression is fast. What we're going to show you here is the sequencer. So this is what you would be operating with, and you're going to see each one of these take items actually references a graphic. So as Gartner goes up and down the sequencer, you're going to see the preview window here changing to represent the graphic that is indicative of this take item line, which is what we refer to these as, our take items. And each take item has its own unique ID via number. So we'll talk about that in a second. But what we're going to show you is the ease of recall here. Gartner is pressing the take button on the expression keyboard, and it is performing a take on each one of these take items, and then it is appearing on our output. So it's very quick and easy to recall your graphics. Now, just because the sequencer is presented to you in a linear list format doesn't mean that you have to go up and down in a linear fashion. With fast recall, we can enable that, and then using the unique take ID number I mentioned earlier, we can type that into the number pad of the keyboard and jump around the sequencer to that number. And then when Gartner hits take, it will go to that specific graphic. Again, and we can even watch his keystrokes as he's typing them in. Very fast and efficient way to recall your graphics during your sportscast. Now we're going to talk about the native clip functionality built into Expression, how you can get it as a server option, and how you can get it as a standalone clip server. So what we're looking at now is the Expression clip interface, which is actually still built in the sequencer. So Gartner can actually switch the layout here back to the sequencer, same place we were just at, and then we can go back to the clips playout. It's all in the same interface. So down here at the bottom, we have the clip browser, where you can see Gartner is pulling clips up from the clip browser and dropping them directly into the clip server channels. We have four of them set up right now, and you can see those over here on my output. So these are the outputs of clip 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now, one thing to make a point of is that each one of these outputs are only taking up one layer on each physical output of the expression. So this expression is outputting 4 fill channels, and each server channel takes up only one layer of the limitless amount of layers you could have on the output. So you could actually run this in conjunction with your lower thirds or your other keyable elements over top on the other layers. It would be like an internal keying system. So how do we populate the clip browser? Well, we have another piece of software called the encoder. And what that does is you would set up a watch folder where you would take your clips and put them in the watch folder. Then the encoder takes the clips out of the watch folder, sucks them up, and flips them into Expression's native codec. It's actually a very efficient codec. So at that point, it then puts them in the clip browser, which is a database that can be synced to other databases and other expression engines, so every engine can actually pull from this database. Now, aside from that, we can also record directly into the browser. So we'll open up a record client, and we can record multiple inputs at the same time. We just need to open up multiple record clients. So Gartner's going to start a record on himself, and we're going to dump it into the D drive. So you see we're recording now. We have our time code. We have a buffer level of 45 frames. And he can even split the record while it's being crash recorded. So now it instantly went to another clip and is recording on that one. So now when Gartner hits stop record, we have our new clips that we just brought into our inputs. So we can right click and do send to clip store. So it's going to put it into that database the same way that the encoder would. So we're gonna type in a name and we're gonna give it a recall ID, which we'll talk about in a second. We're gonna hit transfer clip, and then once it's done, we can search it in the clip browser and it'll be right there. Let's say we had a little bit on the front end of that, or the back end that we didn't want. Oh yes, and the flipbook animation. So we can preview the video just by hovering the thumbnail. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna create a subclip of this. So it's gonna open this up in the add subclip window where we can play back the video. And then we can even set an in and an out. So we're gonna trim the front of this to a certain point, add an in, come over to the backside and add an out. We can rename the subclip and give this an additional recall ID. So now we can search for that subclip and then we can add this to the channel and play it back and even loop it. So you see your current, your remaining time code, and as well as your live preview in the clip server channel in the interface. So with transition logic, we can actually give our graphics more intelligence. We can make them smart graphics by dictating rules and conditions that the graphic is supposed to follow. So for an example, we have a very specific scene here, this lower third generic. This scene represents the template from which that graphic was created from. And then we have the additional information that we put on it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take this graphic online and it animates in a very specific way. So go ahead and animate this out again and then animate it in. So take note that it has a specific animate in effect and animate out. What we're gonna do now is we're going to go to the same type of graphic derived from the same original template. It has different information in it. So now it's going to know when we take that other graphic online that it's not supposed to animate in again. It's actually gonna do a different animation. It's going to dissolve. So through transition logic, we have dictated to this graphic, when this scene is already online, don't reanimate in, do a dissolve. Now another example of that would be this lower third here. This is coming from a different scene type, home bio. So this one with transition logic, we've dictated that because you're a different type of lower third, you're not gonna do a dissolve, but you also shouldn't occupy the same layer at the same time. So when we go to take that next graphic online, this one is going to animate out first. This one is gonna wait for this one to animate out completely and then animate in, and vice versa. Now, these are both occupying the same layer at the same time. Our transition logic actually renders the same or different scene on the same layer in order for that to happen. So you see, two graphics using transition logic are occupying the same layer on one output. Haven't even touched output two yet of this box. And we have another example of this with the away slab. Same principle, they know they're not supposed to occupy the layer at the same time. So when Garner takes that graphic, it's gonna animate out, and this one's gonna wait for it before animating in, and then vice versa. That is transition logic. So with data connectivity, with Expression's data link server option, we can actually connect to an array of different sources, like HTML, text files, Excel sheets, XML, AD/ODB databases, anything that Windows can throw at us. And with our CII gateway, we can do send and improved external update commands. So an example of something that we would want to connect our graphics to in the sports world would be a scoreboard. We want to be able to bring in our score bug information from the scoreboard so that we don't have to continuously watch it and update based on that. We want to just do it automatically. So somewhere off in imaginary land right now, we have a scoreboard and it's going to populate our score bug. So we go and we connect our scoreboard and our clock is going to then start receiving data from it as well. So another way that we could connect to something external would be like an Excel sheet. Like any good sportscaster, we have our own Excel sheet with our players and all of their statistics. Height, weight, class, hometown, full name, even the file path of their headshot. So how is this useful to us? Well, with Datalink, we can connect to these independent fields and then we can do things where we can create data link keys which will dynamically change an entire graphic to pull different lines of the database. So each row has its own number. Each player we would associate to the number of their jersey. So we have a direct correlation between their information and a number that we can recognize. So for instance, when we go back to expression, we would have a graphic like this that would have player information. So we have some data link keys set up. So when Gartner changes the stat page number, he's changing what page of the database it's pulling these four stat categories from all at once based on the row that is set via the jersey number. So the jersey number, as he steps through, is going to change everything on the graphic dynamically as it goes one at a time through the database of row, and all the information will change. So for instance, the art director calls for player jersey number 4, types it in, his information is there, Gartner takes it, it's there. Again, expression is fast and efficient. Package reskinning. During your sportscast, it's important to be able to switch your graphics package quickly and efficiently for a situation where maybe you have multiple matchups during the entire day. First game of the day, you have Team A and Team B. Right after that, maybe only 5 minutes, you have Team C versus Team D. And each team obviously has their own colors and logos, so we want to be able to quickly switch our entire package to match whatever team matchup we are doing for that game. So here on this team matchup slate, we have Team A's logo and colors, and we have Team B's color and logos. So we have some other graphics that are using these as well. So for instance, our home player has the home logo and colors, the away logo and colors, logos and colors and the highlights and everything. So what essentially we are going to do is we're going to make a modification in our spreadsheet that changes dynamically the file paths of all of these locations and materials in our project. And we can do this in two easy steps in less than 30 seconds. So on our game sheet, on our setup tab, we are going to change the away team to something else, New York, and then the home team to something else. And then we're going to save this. That's step one. Step two is we're going to go back to expression and we're going to run our game setup graphic that actually runs a piece of script that will change all those file paths for us based on those two names because of the way our folder hierarchy is. And now, the same graphics that we just showed you have been completely reskinned with logos and color schemes. So you see we have our logos, color, as now our home team, and our away team now has different logos and colors as well. Dashboard panels is another really intricate part of this whole array. For those of you who don't know, dashboard is actually a included software, or not included. You can actually go to the website right now and download this whenever you want. But what it is it's a control interface for your productions. You can use it to control an array of devices, including but not limited to the expression, through various protocols and even native ROS talk, as well as pull information from it because it actually will generate a XML file that we can pull through data link. So here is our custom panel that has both control of the expression and data connectivity to the expression. So when Gartner presses our bug on, it is triggering through ROS talk the expression to say, bring this scene online. If he clicks it again, it'll take it off. So that is the control portion of this. Now we also have these two fields, visitor and home, tied directly to these two fields via data link. And then in dashboard, we actually made little macro buttons that do functions, for instance, increasing the score by certain increments. Or he could come up here and just change it to whatever he wanted. So he can change that to 20, and it's going to instantly change then when he creates another button. And then we can do other things controlling the scenes, like our visitor timeouts. Clicking those will associate in the scene saying these certain things need to be active. Our clock is coming from this clock field that we have built-in controls for that. So we can stop the clock, adjust the clock, reset the clock, which will reset the shot clock as well. And then we'll start it again, and now it's counting down as we have dictated. So anyone can do this, and we even offer services. If you want, we can design the panels for you. So telestration, at some point it may be desired for your sportscaster to draw on an output, maybe like a replay, in order to better illustrate a certain play that maybe just happened. Well, here's how it works. We actually take an expression engine's output and run it into a conversion to get it to HDMI, and then we put it to a touchscreen. We take the input of the expression and feed it with something like a replay server. And the end result would be something like this, where your sportscaster would be able to select certain functions pre-programmed in the keys and then draw on the output. And this is all happening on one layer of expression. So to put that in perspective, we could have CGs on one layer, clips on another layer, and this on another layer, all on a single output. Layered output and frame accurate triggering. I've been telling you guys about layered outputs throughout this entire thing, and we're gonna really nail that down and look at it. But in a situation like this, where you have multiple people hitting the same expression engine, you would have your technical director sitting at your raw security video switcher, triggering natively on the expression through Rostalk things like the replay scene, the bug scene, and you would have your graphics operator triggering things like the lower thirds and the tombstone graphics, while at the same time, your telestrator is running on a different layer so that your sportscaster can draw on the output. So let's put this to the test. We have some graphics here, and what I'm gonna ask Gardner to do is change my layout to playout so that I can show you my output monitors. So really cool features, you could just set it up as many different layouts as you want. So here are my output monitors. What you're seeing here is output one of the expression and output two. There are multiple layers, that's what each one of these lines represent on the output monitor. On the far monitor here, so you know we're not lying to you, we're using two expressions in our entire production right now. One for our clips, like I said, is set up for four fill outputs. So you see our title cards and our sports clip are all coming from that. And then our primary expression, which is set up as a key fill. Every single one of these graphics is gonna occupy only channel one. So Gardner, go ahead and take the burn. So you see that is now occupying layer one of output one, and we see it up here. So now we're gonna go to the next graphic, which is the player lower third. So both of these could be frame accurately triggered from the expression operator. And you see now this is on layer 10. So just because this says layer -3 through +3 doesn't mean that you can't make higher layers or lower layers because it's just an index number. When we're setting it up on our sequencer, we just say what layer it's gonna be on, and it's just going to add it to the output monitor based on that layer. So now we're gonna take the next one, which is going to be the score bug, which could be triggered, again, independently from your ROS switcher or other switcher type. And now, again, you see occupying three layers, we're gonna run a replay wipe that's gonna go on layer 15, and it's actually going to run a piece of script that's gonna clear all the layers below it as we take on another layer, our telestrate scene. And now our big announcement is Tessera, a multi-display real-time graphics designer and controller, which takes multiple expressions and matrices them together to handle things like stadium jumbotrons, video wall monitors, fascia boards, ribbons, and anything you can possibly think of for large, massive, or irregularly shaped monitors or video walls. And that's Tessera. So thank you very much for watching. Again, this is Gardner Millward. My name is Ryan, and thank you.